Very good morning. At the outset, I welcome all my students for the last class of my session. This is indeed the session 20. So here I'll be discussing about some of the important questions that are taken from the question papers, and also I will try to solve a few problems which are rather difficult. And this is in connection with the subject design of steel structural elements, 18 CV 61. Students, I'll be now presenting a few question papers taken from the VTU examination. So this is how the pattern of the questions are going to be. Now, as far as the module 1 is concerned, as you know, this is something connected with basics of steel structures and also the limit state method of steel, and we also have a chapter connected with plastic analysis and design. Now, if you go through these questions, the questions are rather simple, and in fact many of the answers for these questions will be able to get from IS 800 also. So let us go through the questions and try to clarify what the answers for these questions are. The first question, as you know, explain the advantages and disadvantages of steel structure. So in fact this has been covered in the first session, and there are about 8 to 10 advantages, and of course you also have 4 to 5 disadvantages. I request the students to go through my notes and also my PPT presentation, which is given to VTU, and also the video lecture, and that will cover the answer to the first question. And also we have the second question, distinguish between working stress design and the limit state design, and this, in fact this is also been covered in the first session in greater details, and we have a lot of information available as far as these two methods of designs are concerned. As you know, the working stress method of design is also referred to as the allowable stress method of design or the permissible stress method of design, and sometimes factor of safety method of design, where certain factor of safety for the maximum yield strength of the material is being used. And similarly, so the limit state method of design, you can get some answer from IS 800 also, and as a part of this you need to discuss about the different limit states that are considered in the steel design. So we know we have the limit state of collapse, so that's where the strength of the material comes into picture. After that we have different limit states in tension, limit state in compression, limit state in bending, limit state in shear. Of course you also have the serviceability limit states, where deflection and the local buckling, corrosion, durability, so many such things are being covered. So we get answer not only from the textbooks, and few answers you will be able to get from IS 800 also. Now coming to the question 2, so it is on shape factor. So what is the shape factor of a triangular section? In fact we have derived this one, and I will be going through the derivation also, just glancing the two pages of information as a part of the derivation. So the value is 2.34. so in fact this is the only section where the value of the shape factor is very high. Now kindly see the problem that is on the beam, where it is simply supported and a portion of the beam is extended as an overhang. And if you see the span AB, so the load is UDL, but it is not constant over the entire span. So it is cut off at some point. So where the length of the UDL is about 4 meters, and for the remaining 2 meters of the beam, so there is no UDL. So it is a partial UDL on the beam. And also you have the cantilever part, where some load is also being put at the end. And if you see the way the beam is going to bend, so we have the positive bending moment as far as the span AB is concerned, and we have the negative bending because of the cantilevering effect. And when you determine the total load as far as the span AB is concerned, so we need to consider the positive effect of the load on the span AB, and at the same time we need to consider the negative effect of the load that is there in the overhang portion BC, so that will have an influence on the behavior of AB. So this particular problem I will be working out at the end, where we will be appreciating this problem, the importance of both the loads comes into picture. So this is where the module 1 as far as this particular question paper is concerned. And kindly see the module 1 taken from yet another question paper. And in fact, it is more or less the same question. What are the advantages and disadvantages of using steel structure? So as I mentioned in the previous question also, you can get the answer from my presentation materials. Explain briefly Remistad method of design of structure. So you can refer IS 800 and write maybe a pair of information or a page of information depending on the availability of the time. Of course, there are two different types of Remistads: Remistad with respect to strength and Remistad with respect to serviceability. And of course, the different types under these two categories also need to be explained. What are rolled steel used for, or the rolled steel sections? In fact, we have different types of rolled steel sections. You have rolled I sections, channel section, T sections, angle sections, tubular sections. Of course, you also have solid bars, wires, and in each of these I sections and channel sections, we have different categories. So we have the heavyweight, medium weight, lightweight, and junior category also you have, and many of these things needed to be discussed. And one typical sketch and how these sections are designated, so that also need to be explained. So mention the different types of rolled sections used in the construction. So in fact, I have covered the answer for this also. So some theory so need to be presented very systematically, keeping in mind the availability of the time and also the marks given to the question. Now coming to the question number 2, so you need to explain these two terms, so plastic hinge and collapse mechanism. So in fact, the explanation to what plastic hinge and the mechanism is already being covered, so you can refer to the notes. Find the shear factor and plastic moment capacity for a built-up beam shown in the figure. Now kindly see the figure, how it looks like. So in fact, it is the I section. In many of the question papers, the shear factor for the I section itself is asked. But if you see this section, so this section appears to be the symmetric section. Kindly see the thickness of the top and bottom flange is same. So it's about 14 mm. And the thickness of the web is also 14 mm. And we have one more flange, not only at the top, but also at the bottom. So the whole section is symmetric. So I will be discussing this problem also. So it involves hardly 2 steps. If you meticulously work out just in 2 steps, by using a simple approach, you will be able to determine the shear factor for this section. So we will be seeing this at the end. And also see the second question. So this is with respect to the plastic moment capacity MP of the section. And kindly see the problem. So we have 2 spans here. One is 4 meter span. So the span acts as a fixed beam. So we have the MP at the end span and also the continuous support. And of course, we have 1 MP at the center of the span. So if you see the second span, so BC, so we need to consider 3 separate mechanisms. So it is the B mechanism, where 1 plastic hinge is going to come at the first concentrated load. And in the second case, the plastic hinge coming at the second concentrated load. And of course, in the third mechanism, so we have the plastic hinges under both the concentrated loads, in addition to 1 plastic hinge at this continuity point B. And of course, at C, we don't have the plastic hinge. So the span of the beam, as you can see, it is 6 meter. The loads are kept at 2 meter. So it's a symmetric beam, but only thing is the C is simply supported, where it acts as a mechanical hinge and there is no plastic hinge formation. And another point that need to be looked at is the plastic capacity of the left span AB is MP. For the span BC is 2 MP. So when you are analyzing either of the spans as far as B is concerned, so we need to put the plastic hinge, but with the plastified moment equal to MP. But when you are forming the mechanism under the load 20 kN or even under another 20 kN, so that's where the MP coming at those points is 2 MP. So we need to be very careful to put 2 MP as far as the plastic hinge, either at the left 20 or the right 20 turn, depending on the mechanism. And of course, we also have one mechanism where we will be considering the plastic hinges to form under both the loads. So there also it is 2 MP. So in fact, I have worked out this problem and we'll be discussing this in a short while from now. Let us move on to the next question paper. Again, if you see the first question 1A, mention the failure criteria of steel with examples. Explain any one in brief. In fact, there are many design criteria depending on the type of the load to which the member is subjected to. It may be a tension member, and we have two criteria. So one is yielding of the gross section, and another is fracture of the net section. And if it is a compression member, so it is the limit state as far as compression is concerned, where the member can undergo failure by yielding, or it can even undergo failure by buckling. So in fact, we have the different criteria as far as the behavior of beam is concerned. So we have the limit state of collapse as far as moment is concerned. So limit state of shear comes into picture. And of course, we also have secondary failures due to buckling. So explain these failure criteria depending on the type of the member and the load to which it is subjected to, and then explain any one failure criteria in a greater detail with the help of a neat sketch. So this is for 10 mark. So in fact, this is also being covered in one of the sessions under B. So the second one, if you see, it is explain briefly class 1, class 2, class 3 sections. In fact, we also have one more, class 4 sections. So that is where the plastic section, so compact section, semi-compact section, and class 4 being the slender section. And in fact, we have the definition of all these sections available in IS 800. Especially, I request the students to have a look at IS 800 2007 and get the needed answer. And also we need to write one diagram where moment curvature relationship and how exactly it varies and what will be the nature of the stress across the cross section. So that's also very important. As far as the class 1 section is concerned, being plastic, so the entire cross section gets plastified. So the whole section will be having the yield stress. And of course, in the second class 2, we have the same type of stress distribution, but mind you, the section undergoes continuous doesn't undergo continuous deformation because it is just compact. So in case of class 1, so full plastification happens. So the section is able to develop EMP, but the section undergoes continuous plastic deformation, and the rotation of the plastic hinge is possible in class 1. But in class 2, rotation of the plastic hinge will not be there. But EMP is what the capacity of the section. But in case of class 3, it is some sort of a plastic and elastic distribution of the stress. It is elastoplastic in nature. So, and obviously, this section is not able to develop the plastic moment. And of course, as I mentioned, we also have the slender section where the moment carrying capacity is substantially less. It is definitely less than the yield moment of the section. So this is where the plastification of the section is not going to happen. So many of these things we need to describe in detail and with the help of moment curvature relation, and also taking the distribution of the stress across the section where the moment is maximum. And if you see the question C, so this is a very simple question, but I request the students to write some 2-3 sentences for each of these diagrams. So name the following elements. So in fact, this is an I section. First write that this is I section. So this is a built up section. So where the section is consisting of two angles. And again, this is a built up section. So it is built by using one channel at the compression flange. And of course, we have one I section. Now coming to the left section. So this is the I section. In fact, we have the outstands. So this is the flange. Flange has got outstand. And otherwise we have the web. So web being the internal element. So these are all the external elements referred to as the outstand. The whole section is referred to as an open section. So this is not a closed section like a tube. So we need to bring in these three distinctions as far as the three sketches are concerned. The second one, as I told you, is a built-up section. It is an open section, not a closed section. but each element has got outstands. So one is the outstand, it is not connected, and of course the remaining two outstands are being connected to the gusset plate. You can also see the dotted line, so that is where the gusset plate comes into picture. So this is open section. So this is also the open section, built up section consisting of eye section and channel, but we have the web, and of course we have the outstands, and we have the flange being the internal element as far as the channel is concerned, and of course at the two ends so we have the outstands of the channel, so being the flange of the channel. So these are all some of the things we need to discuss. So that's where three marks comes into picture. So three simple sentences for each of these three diagrams, if we explain, so we get full mark. And now if you see the second question, so this is something connected with the determination of the shape factor, and definitely students can expect one question as far as the shape factor is concerned. It is either on the derivation or a simple problem, so where we have an eye section or a built up section, and this is the eye section, but this is an unsymmetric eye section. So in an unsymmetric eye section, so kindly look at very carefully the centroid, and of course through the centroid so we have the neutral axis, and that is where the elastic section modulus comes into picture. So we need to determine the moment of inertia, the second moment of area of the section with respect to that horizontal centroidal axis. And of course if you see the longitudinal centroidal axis, this is towards the top flange because we have more area concentrated at the top. So obviously slightly above the mid depth, so we have that centroidal axis, and we have the distance of the extreme fiber to the top and also to the bottom. So while calculating the maximum value of the elastic section modulus, we need the distance of the farthest extreme fiber. So that is where Y1 or Y2, whichever is more, comes into picture. So the distance from the centroid with respect to the bottom flange, so that is what the Y max. So with respect to that, calculate the elastic section modulus. And of course here the sections are very simple, where we'll be able to calculate the area because the dimensions are whole numbers, and find out half the area. So that is where determination of the equal area axis comes into picture. Once the equal area axis is determined, and we have elements, two elements at the top, and of course we also have two elements at the bottom. So we can go by elements, the two elements at the top and two elements at the bottom, their area and the centroid distance. So take the moment of all the elements with respect to the equal area axis. So that gives you the plastic section modulus. So in fact, a similar type of problem I have worked out at the end. One problem of this type will be discussed. Now if you see the problem B, 2B, again this is very simple. We need to determine the plastic moment because the load on the beam is given, so as a numerical. So we need to determine what is MP of the left span AB and also the span BC. The problem is very simple, but we need to be very careful as far as the span BC is concerned. So that's where some trickiness comes into picture. Otherwise the problem is very simple. So we need to identify the load, work done by the external load. So we have the UDL over the entire span. So it's good that the load is over the entire span and it is not partial. And if it is partial, then we need to differentiate the work equation, and otherwise it's not possible to identify the point where the bending moment is maximum. In fact, in this case also we need to identify the point where the bending moment is maximum because we have UDL and also we have a point load, but very close to the center, but towards the point load. So we have the maximum bending moment, and that location, that point, and its distance either from B or from C needed to be identified, and that is the location where we need to show one plastic hinge. And of course they have the plastic hinge at C because it is fixed, and of course at B because of the continuity we have the moment, and one more plastic hinge will come into picture. But as far as the span AB is concerned, so it is a propped beam. So at the support A there is no plastic moment, so at B we have the plastic moment, and of course close to the center, but you know the distance. So at 0.414 from A of the distance L. So 0.414 into 4 meter is what the distance at which you have the plastic moment. And in fact, we have the formula for that. Formula for MP that can be used straight away. And otherwise, we can also work out from the mechanism depending on the situation. So let us see how the span BC can be considered for the calculation of MP. So this also I will be discussing at the end. And now if you see the module, so this is something connected with the design of beam. And you can expect some theory, so not much theory you have in this, some 5 to 6 common questions you find in many of the question papers. So try to identify those simple questions and get ready with the answers to those questions. Now kindly see the first question, 9A. What are the factors which affect the lateral stability? So this is what the question I find in many of the questions, question papers. So we have about 6 to 8 factors, so which we'll be considering at the end of this particular presentation. So there is a problem here. So determine the design bending strength of beam ISMB 300 at 434 Newton per meter being the length per meter. Assume that the factored shear force is less than the design strength. So this is a problem where we need to identify what is the moment carrying capacity of the member beam. So it is the design bending strength of the beam, and the beam is assumed to be laterally supported. In fact, that is not mentioned here, but if you see the syllabus, so the problem related to laterally supported beam only is to be discussed. But as far as the laterally unsupported beam is concerned, we need to know the full theory, but the problems need not have to be discussed from the examination point of view. So keeping that thing in mind, so this is the problem connected with laterally supported member. So kindly go through the steel table or IS 800 and find out what is the plastic section modulus of this particular beam. So if you know the plastic section modulus, so we can calculate the moment carrying capacity. So the moment carrying capacity is the plastic section modulus into Fy. And of course, that needed to be divided by gamma MO, because we need the design yield strength of the material, and that has to be obtained from the characteristic strength. So kindly see here Fe 410. 410, you take it as the characteristic strength of the steel. So Fy is 410. Obviously, 410 divided by 1.1. So is the design strength, and that multiplied by the plastic section modulus. So that is where the bending strength of the ISMB can be determined. But if you see the mark, it is 12 marks, but this is very high. But otherwise, it's a more mark actually. But the answer is just in one simple calculation, so you'll be able to determine. And also, he is mentioning that assume that the factored shear force is less than the design shear strength. Means the shear is also not having a substantial effect on the bending strength. So because the shear is not taking much of the area of the web, so obviously the entire area of the web is still available for the bending strength calculation. So that's where the problem is rather simple, but I feel that the mark is slightly onto the higher side. Now if you see the second question, so you can either attempt the first one or the second one. And out of the 4 question papers which I have collected, 3 question papers has the problem very similar to the one so what I am discussing now. So this is on a room or maybe a hall having some dimension, so where the I-beams are kept at some spacing, and of course all these beams are supporting a RCC slab where the thickness of the slab is given, and of course, the finishing load also will be given in some problem. Otherwise, we need to assume the finishing load. The live load, like 2 kN per meter square, 3.54, some value we will be finding. And of course, we need to determine an appropriate section and then determine the bending strength from all other criteria. Check for shear, check for deflection. And of course, lastly, we need to check for vertical buckling of the web. and the crimpling of the web also. But in some problem, so he'll be clearly mentioning as to what secondary checks we need to do. Do the check for deflection and maybe for shear and something like that. If nothing is mentioned, so probably we need to do all the checks. Now kindly say this is the problem where nothing is mentioned. We need to design for moment, check for shear and check for deflection and toe buckling. We need to do it. So that is where this problem comes into picture. So let us just discuss any one of these problems, which I will be doing at the end. Now, if you see the other question paper, because module 1 I have discussed, so the module 5 of the second question paper, briefly explain the factors affecting lateral stability of beams. So it is the same question. So as I mentioned, we have some 6 to 8 factors. So we need to explain each of these factors in about 3 to 5 sentences. Now kindly see this problem. So this is very similar to the problem which you have seen in the previous question paper. So very similar to this one. Again, so we have the design in one intermediate beam where he has given the span clearly. So it is 6 meter clear span, and obviously he has to give the bearing. So the bearing is given here. So obviously the effective span can be determined, 6 plus of the bearing on either support. So it is 6.3 being the effective span. And of course, the spacing of the I sections. So it is 3.5 meter center to center. So this is how the beams are kept. So we need to convert the total load as a UDL along the beam. So that is where some calculation comes into picture. And the thickness of the RCC slab in the previous problem. So it was 100 mm. Now it is 130 mm. The live load is 5 kN per meter squared, slightly onto the higher side. So obviously we get a heavy section as far as this problem is concerned. And also see the finish. So it is generally around 1 kN per meter squared, but here it is 1.5. And the beam is laterally supported or laterally restrained. So this is what the case in all the problems. Check for shear and moment capacity and deflection. So we need not have to do any check for vertical buckling of the web and the vertical crippling of the web. So these two things not be done as a part of the question. And kindly see the last question, being the second question under the module 5. It is basically the theory, and some answers definitely you get it from IS 800, because that is one of the document you can refer in examination. And to the extent of about 60-70% of the mark, if you are careful in going through the code and take those appropriate information and write it in your own sentence, not simply copying the information from the IS 800 as it is, it becomes unethical. So look to the information and transfer the information very carefully, and see that some answer is generated out of IS 800. And if you know certain things as an additional thing, so substantiate the answer and see that you get the full 20 mark. So write a note on laterally unsupported beam. So kindly say it is not supported, it is laterally unrestrained. So this is where the lateral buckling of the beam comes into picture, which has been discussed in greater detail in one of the sessions. So where the beam bends vertically and at the same time it bends in the lateral direction. At some point in time, so the cross section starts twisting. So this is where lateral torsional flexural buckling comes into picture, and there is a critical moment corresponding to the onset of that twisting effect, and that is where the importance of the critical moment and various factors I mentioned in the previous question paper, and discuss some of those factors which will have an influence. And definitely in this case, the beam is not able to develop the plastic moment capacity. So that is what you need to remember. So full plastification is not going to happen because the cross section buckles. So obviously a certain area of the cross section has been utilized for resisting the twisting effect that leads to buckling, and whatever the resistance that is available, so that only will be able to carry a certain amount of moment. So full plastification is not there, is what you need to remember. So briefly explain the different types of seated connections. In fact, we have two types of seated connection. So one is a stiffened seated connection, another one is unstiffened seated connection. But if you see the syllabus carefully, because this is the question paper taken from the previous scheme where the seated connection might have been there in the syllabus, but with the current syllabus, so there is no seated connection. But still, I suggest students to have a glance through some of these informations from the point of theory, referring to some standard textbooks, say the textbook by Dugal or by Subramaniam or any other standard textbook you can refer and get some information as far as these things are concerned. And some information still you will be able to get from IS 800 also. You explain the necessity of providing column splices. So with neat sketches, write about any two types of column splices. Of course, splice is the art of joining the member, because all these members, as you know, whether it is I section or channel sections, they are available in certain length. So depending on what type of transportation facilities you have in your place, and of course the type of industry catering to the manufacturing. So 10 meter, 12 meter, 15 meter is what the length you can expect. But in case of a multi-story building, so definitely we need to have the member going for a height of 20, 30, 40 meters. And that's where at some locations we need to go for joining. So that's where the splice comes into picture. It can be for column or it can be for beam. Accordingly, we have the column splices and beam splices. So this is for the column splice. So I explain the splice in particular, and where we'll be providing the splice in column is also very important. We need to avoid certain critical locations, the locations where the shear force is maximum. So that is where the connection of the beam with the column comes into picture. So they are the locations where the shear is maximum and we have a substantial amount of the joint moment. And also over the height of the column, generally at the mid height of the column. So the moment is generally maximum, and these locations need to be avoided, and probably in between, but very close to the support where bending moment and shear force is rather minimum. So that is a location where we need to provide the splice, so that with that reduced bending moment and shear force, the splice as a connection will have less material, and of course the fasteners so that needed to be used also will be quite economical. So these are all some of the points we need to discuss. And the three different types of splices, two you have to explain, but when columns are of same size, so how we will be providing the splice, so that has been discussed in the last session. And sometimes the size of the beam will be different. The top bottom one will be larger, the top one will be slightly smaller beam. And we need to provide sometimes the base plate also, depending on what is the amount of moment to which the splice is subjected to. And sometimes we also have the shear. So depending on whether the splice needed to be designed for the axial load and shear force, axial load and moment, axial load, moment and shear. So we need to take up the design. And of course, design is not there. So depending on the type and combinations of the loads, we need to have the flange plate and of course the base plate. And we need to design a separate plate which takes the shear. So that is where the design of the plate connecting the web of the two portions of the column comes into picture. So there are different sketches available in textbooks, and also we have this information available in IS 800 also under one of the annexes, so where we'll be able to get the details. Now this is where the third question paper, again the module 5, and kindly see this problem. Again, it is the more or less the same problem compared to the previous one. So if a student gets ready for one problem of this type, I'm sure so that will definitely come in the examination. And of course, we also have some theory. So in that sense, module 5 is really not that difficult even for an average student, and of course even for the slow learners. And if you get ready for some of these theory questions and practice one or two problems of this type, yes, very easily you'll be able to score one full mark for about 15, 16 marks or for about 20 marks depending on the situation. Now what is this problem is? So design a simply supported I section to support a slab of a hall of 9 meter by 24 meter. So the clear span is 9 meter. And obviously we'll have given the bearing, and if the bearing is not given, then you have to assume the bearing. So kindly see, in this problem bearing is not given, so maybe around 300 mm of bearing you can assume. So with that, 9.3 meter will become the effective span, and has given the spacing 3 meter center to center. So obviously out of these two dimensions, the smaller one is generally the span. So write the size of the hall and then see how best we will be able to accommodate the number of beams based on the span and the dimension 24 meter in this case. So we have certain number of beams coming into picture. So over the series of beams we have the RCC slab whose thickness is 100 mm. So this definitely constitute to the additional live load, and the actual live load from the point of occupancy. So depending on what type of occupancy for which the hall is meant, so we have to take from IS code, but it is given here as 3 kN per meter square, and the finished load is 0.5 kN per meter square, 0.5, 1, 1.5 depending on the situation. So the type of the steel is given here. So the yield stress of the steel is 250 Newton per mm square. So that's what you need to remember. So kindly see that the adequate lateral support to the compression flange is given here. So because it is a laterally supported member, not an unsupported member, obviously we need to strengthen the compression part so that so there is no buckling in the lateral direction happens. So for which we have the design procedure. And kindly say we need to design only for the moment, and we need to check for the shear. So that's very important, because these are the two major structural action coming into picture. So bending and shear, limit state of collapse in bending, limit state of collapse in shear. And as for the secondary checks are concerned, from the serviceability point of view, it is only with respect to deflection. So again, so check for vertical buckling and crippling is not there. And kindly see the theory. So many of the theory already we have seen in the earlier question paper. So what is the shear strength of steel beam and how it is calculated, and we have a formula, so you can get the formula straight away from the code. It is the entire web area that comes into picture as far as the shear strength is concerned. So we need to discuss about low shear case and also high shear case, and explain the importance of the stress Fy upon root 3. So this is where the octahedral shear stress comes into picture, and it is not the Fy, the yield stress in tension is not the yield stress in shear. So that is where we need to be very careful. So try to explain with one or two sentence about what the yield stress corresponding to shear yielding. So based on Fy, which is the yielding corresponding to tension. So laterally unsupported beam, so this has been covered earlier also, and of course it's the same factors, 6 to 8 factors, so discussed in the session, so can be written down systematically. So column splice, so this also I explained in the previous question paper. So friends, so having gone through these three question papers, I think the module 1 and module 5 is very simple, and getting about 80+% of mark is very easy, even for an average student. And of course for many students who have really prepared based on the way this has been tackled, so I'm sure you'll be able to get a full mark, and it's not that difficult. So I'm covering only the two modules because I'm connected with these two modules as far as the VTU responsibility is concerned, and try to go through the other modules also, and I'm sure the other faculty members also might be interested in discussing few question papers. I'm sure at the end we'll have full confidence to handle this particular subject where we'll be able to score very high mark. So even for the average students and also for the slow learners, so average students means they need some time for learning, and even for the slow learners, so with this much of a preparation, I'm sure so your examination is really not a difficult one, and getting high mark is also not that difficult. Now, this is where the factors affecting the lateral stability comes into picture, and all these things I have discussed in my notes also. And kindly see the cross-sectional property. So this is what you need to appreciate. So the moment of inertia with respect to the horizontal axis, with respect to vertical axis, the combined effect Iz plus Iy. So that's where the polar moment of inertia comes into picture. So that's where the torsional rigidity. So the flexural rigidity, torsional rigidity, everything comes into picture. And of course the material properties. So the modulus of elasticity and the shear modulus also comes into picture. And what is the ratio of Iz by Iy? But if you take a tubular section where it is square, so Iz upon Iy is 1. It has the same resistance in horizontal as well as in vertical direction passing through the centroid. But in case of an I section, and we have seen this, Iz is many times more compared to Iy. So 20, 30, 50, sometimes in deep sections it is close to 100 plus. So that's where the resistance with respect to y direction is almost negligible. So the polar modulus is more or less equal to the value of Iz only. So that's where the importance of these moments of inertia play a very important role. And flexural rigidity, of course, torsional rigidity. Support conditions, effective length of the compression flange depending on how it is connected at the ends. And the level of application of the transverse load also plays an important role, whether the load is applied at the top of, that is to the compression flange, or to the web where the load is rather close to the centroidal axis, or if it is at the bottom to the tension flange. So obviously the problem of lateral buckling doesn't come into picture. So only when the load is acting on the compression flange we have the problem. Distance between the lateral supports, and sometimes we do provide the lateral support, and what is the distance and how that support is provided and how it is connected, whether it is welded or bolted. So all these things definitely plays an important role. Restraints at the end and at the intermediate support locations. So the boundary conditions. The boundary condition mainly with respect to what is the type of movement that is really possible. Again, that depends on the type of the connections. So type and position of the load also important, whether it's a concentrated load or a UDL or a varying load. And obviously the position of the load, whether the load is acting on the compression flange from the top on the compression flange, or is that the load is applied onto the tension flange, or the load is acting on the cross section but the point of application of the load is passing through the centroid. So these are all locations, so that will have an influence on the nature of the lateral bending, and accordingly so we have the behavior. And of course the moment gradient along the length, again it depends on the end conditions. So we have the fixed moment coming into picture, and we also have the free bending moment coming into picture, the variation depending on the load and the combinations of the load. So many of these things needed to be discussed. And kindly see the expression for the critical moment. So we'll be able to identify the different parameters so that are responsible for the behavior, and whatever the factors of the cross section I mentioned in the previous slide, so we will be able to see here also. And this is one simple problem on the beam. So what is important is so we need to write the size of the room and identify what is the clear span and then the effective span, and try to identify the position of one of the beam and what is the load contributing to the behavior of that beam. So taking of the span of the spacing on either side of the beam. So that is what I have explained here. The same thing you can see from in my presentation also. So converting the surface load into the UDL. So multiplying the entire effect with the spacing comes into picture. So with that, so we have the UDL on the beam, and then the maximum bending moment and shear force can be determined. And of course, so we have some systematic steps to complete the design. And this is what the problem in one of the question paper, my dear friends. So kindly see the positive and negative effects. I'm not discussing this problem completely. So here we have the B mechanism. As you can see here, this is what the B mechanism. And kindly see the two links. One is the left, another is the right link. And because of this overhanging effect, so that links gets projected as if it is straight up to the end. And B mechanism is really not this triangular part of the figure. It is an extended part of the figure also that needed to be considered, because the external work is not only because of this partial UDL on the span AB, and is also due to the concentrated load that is coming at the end. When you have a heavy load on the span AB, so the beam gets pushed. But here, if this load of 20 kN, if this is also quite heavy, so then definitely, so the bending towards the downside also comes into picture. But if you see this 20 kN, so this is not a heavy load. So obviously we have the effect of this cantilever load going in the other direction. So that is where the negative effect of the load comes into picture. So, and also from the calculation you can make out, so whether this effect is really downwards or to the upward direction. So in fact, this is going to be negative effect as far as this problem is concerned. And also kindly see in the mechanism, in this triangular part, we need to consider that area of the triangle which is contributing to the UDL. So that is where the length of the UDL comes into picture, which is 4 meter. And if you take that 4 meter, so we have a triangular part of the mechanism and also a small trapezium part comes into picture. In other words, whatever the area I have hatched, like a trapezium, so that entire area comes into picture. So that is where the intensity of the load under the ultimate condition multiplied by the area of the mechanism which covers the length of the UDL, because for the remaining portion of 2 meters, so we don't have the load effect. So we need this entire area. So that is where we need to be very careful. So one hinge at the left A comes into picture, at B because of continuity one hinge, and of course at the point where the bending moment is maximum, so we have one hinge, where MP for all these three hinges is, kindly see here, it is 2 MP as far as the left portion is concerned, but here it is MP. So obviously at A we have 2 MP, at this location, so at, close to the center of the span, we have 2 MP. At this point B, so it is to the left and right, if you see the minimum MP that counts, so that's where MP comes into picture here. And we need to identify the location where the bending moment is likely to be maximum. So it is close to the center, but I really don't know what is the distance, but I have called the distance as X with respect to B. And obviously the remaining portion, 6 minus of X, so that you will be able to present here. And at that location, what is the deflection, that is delta 1, I have shown, and that is needed to take the effect of UDL. And also we need one ordinate corresponding to end of the UDL, so that's where delta 2 comes into picture, because we need the area of this entire diagram that comes under the UDL. So with this diagram and with this representation of theta 1 and theta 2, because it is exactly not at the center because we don't know, so let us call this as X. Corresponding to that we have theta 2, for 6 minus of X we have theta 1. So obviously this delta 1 at the location where the moment is maximum, so we have this delta 1, that is equal to 6 minus X theta 1, that is equal to X into theta 2. So that's where what is theta 1 and theta 2 you will be able to calculate from this relation. Now kindly see how this can be worked out. So we have the external work done by this partial UDL. Of course you also have the external work done by the concentrated load which is acting at C as a cantilever load. So this effect, as I mentioned, so I'm considering this to be the negative effect. So compared to the substantial positive effect of the load on the span AB, so that is where so the first portion of the load we also need to consider, and of course we need to take the loading effect as far as the second one is concerned. So this is 20 into 1.5 and this is 15 into 1.5. So to convert the given working load to ultimate load. And kindly see here, I have not put minus, but we need to identify the theta 2. So that theta 2, as far as this portion is concerned, is negative. So in fact, the deflection is also going in the other direction. So the delta 3, if you calculate, so that is 2 meter into theta 2. So 2 meter into theta 2, this is negative. So I should have written negative here. So if you make this negative, we will be able to get the total load corresponding to the total external work corresponding to the given two loads. Now, as far as the internal work is concerned, so it is very simple. So kindly say here it is 2MP. Kindly say this is not MP, so it is 2MP. So you need to write it as 2MP here, and this is where it is MP, and this is where it is 2MP. As far as the calculation of the load is concerned, but otherwise in the bending moment diagram, so we will be writing the bending moment diagram corresponding to the collapse. So that is where what MP you calculate with some numerical value. So that is what the value you are showing here. But otherwise, but for the calculation of the internal work done by the plastic hinges, we need to take those appropriate values of the moment. Here it is 2MP. Here again it is 2MP. So take these things into consideration very carefully. So I have put that value here, 2MP theta 1 here, and here also I have written it as 2MP theta 1 plus theta 2, and kindly see here it is only MP. So the minimum of the two values to the left and to the right. So with this what you get here, the internal work as a function of theta 1 and x, but your external work is also a function of theta 1 and x, and equating these two, we have an expression for MP which is a function of x, and differentiate that MP with respect to x and find out x and substitute that x back into the expression for the MP which you are differentiating. So you will be able to get the moment, the plastic moment for this entire beam. And also, if required, you can also work out one small mechanism for this cantilevering part itself. There is also a mechanism, but the MP what you are going to get from that, so it is straight away the answer is known to you. So that MP is nothing but so 20 into 1.5 into this 2 meter. So that is where the value of 60 kilonewton per meter is what the answer only from the cantilever mechanism. So that is a very small value. So obviously the value what you get from the left span AB is the one that really controls this problem. Now kindly see this problem as far as the shear factor is concerned. So I told you, so the equal area axis is exactly passing through the centroid, and even the centroidal axis also is at this point. So it is a doubly symmetric section. So IZ, you can calculate it straight away. How I have done this problem is I have taken the total area corresponding to 400, so divided by the entire depth as if it is a rectangle. So that is where B d cube by 12 comes into picture, the overall depth being 444. So this is 400 and this 12 plus 10, 22, and another 22, so that is 44. So that is a I for the entire cross section, considering it as a closed rectangle. And then you have to subtract the two components of the rectangle, one to the left and one to the right. And of course, you also have one smaller rectangular parts, one to the left and one to the right. So the width is known and the depth is also known. So that's where the negative effect of the depth 424 over this small width comes into picture, because this is 400. So this is 250. So in fact, we have the leftover is 150, but one portion is 75. So I have taken 75 into d cube by 12. So because we also have a similar type of portion to the other side, I have multiplied that with 2. And now you need to subtract, so this area and of course this area effect. So what is this area effect? So 250 is what the width of the internal I section minus the thickness. If you subtract, it is 240. So the same 240 into depth cube by 12 straight away I have taken. So you get the value of I. So this is what the I, so in terms of mm to the power of 4, divided by the extreme fiber distance. So that is constant in this case. 444 is being the entire depth, half of that is 222 being y max. So you straight away get the answer. So it is a very, very simple approach. So in case of symmetry, so make use of the advantage of symmetry and calculate Iz. So just in one statement as a equation, you will be able to get the answer. And what is the plastic section modulus? The plastic section modulus, as you know, it is the moment of the area of all the elements, not only to the top and even to the bottom of the equal area axis. All areas needed to be considered. So this 400 into 10 and its center, and what is the distance, and the second area, its center and the distance, the third area, so and its center and the distance. So not only for the top and even for the bottom, both gets added up because the moment is of one nature. So that is what I have done it here. So I have done it for the top, the whole thing multiplied by 2. Top area 400 into 10, so the distance you can make out. So that distance is 270. The second area, so you know, width and depth is 250 into 12. Its area and the distance, so that's where 206 comes into picture. The third area is this one, small area, so that's where 10 over of the depth 200, and of course the overall depth is 400, so of the depth is 200, its center is at 100, so that's where this 100 comes into picture. The whole thing, the top area with respect to ZZ being the equal area axis, and a similar type of calculation for the bottom. So the whole thing into 2. So this is what the answer. So kindly see, plastic section modulus is slightly more compared to the elastic section modulus, and if we take the ratio of the plastic section modulus to elastic section modulus, it is definitely more than 1, but close to 1.1, and that is where the shape factor for the I section or a built-up section comes into picture. And one more thing is, if it is only an I section, your answer is close to 1.1 to 1.5. But here we are putting two additional areas, but that area is going away. So compared to that area, the area which is very close to the centroidal axis is rather very less. And like that, if you start putting additional plates, so you can assume that the plate areas are too much compared to the web area. In that case, it's a section where you really do not have the web. So in such situation, as I told you, so the shape factor is rather close to 1, where you have two flanges kept at some distance, where we really do not have web or a negligible web, then it is rather close to 1. So that is what the situation here, it is 1.1. So if you round off, it's mainly because of the fact that, so we have the two flanges coming into picture, where web is not increased in terms of area. So that's where it is rather close to 1. And this is another example. So it is a very simple one, because this is like a fixed beam, and we have the expression for the moment. So straight away you can get the answer for this. And as far as the other portion is concerned, because we have two concentrated loads, so obviously we have three mechanisms coming into picture, which I explained in one of the similar type of problem which I have considered in one of my sessions. So the hinge coming at the left point load, and similarly the hinge coming at the right point load, and of course the works are not same, so you have to be very careful, because in one case we need to identify the external work done by both the loads, but the hinge is coming once at left and the second case at the right point load. So these two mechanisms need to be worked out separately, and because of symmetry, so you may get the same answer for these two mechanisms. So kindly check that one. And the another mechanism, so which looks like this, so like a trapezium. So your mechanism diagram is like a trapezium, where these two deflections delta being same because of symmetry. Symmetry with respect to the load, because the same load, and even the spacing is also 2 meter center to center. So in that sense, so it's a symmetric mechanism. Kindly say, to the left it is MP, to the right it is 2MP, but at this support for both the mechanisms, that is controlled by MP. Kindly say it is MP. But for this span, so under the point load here, so it's always be 2 MP. So that's where you have to be very careful. So kindly work out this problem and get ready with these types of continuous beam problem. So it is 2 span, but sometimes it can be even 3 span also. So even if it is 4 span, not an issue. Only thing is it takes maybe another 5 to 10 minutes extra. So maximum of 3 span continuous beam, so you can expect in the examination. So this is what the calculations, you need not to worry. And of course, the shape factor for the triangular section explained in greater detail in one of my session. The same thing I am putting it here, so that you can recollect those moments. And finally, the answer, as I mentioned, it is 2.343. So please get ready with this preparation. So it needs one or two times deriving this at your own level comes into picture. And this is the last problem. So the left span is very easy to solve as far as MP is concerned. So this is you know the distance here at which the bending moment is maximum. So that is 0.414 L from A. And the formula for the moment itself we have derived. So that formula you can bring it here and calculate what is the MP, 68.61. But as far as the span BC is concerned, it is not just UDL. So there is one additional concentrated load coming into picture. This is where the problem is a bit tricky. So kindly see the point where the moment is maximum. So not exactly at the center, slightly away from the center towards C. So that's what the section where you get MP. Assume that that is at X, and obviously the remaining distance is 6 minus of X. So if you call one angle as theta, the other one is theta 1, get the relation between theta and theta 1. So that is what you need to do it. As far as the location where the point load 100 kN is acting, we need the deflection, because that load into deflection. So and that deflection, straight away you can get it as delta 2 equal to this span, that is 2 meter into theta 1. So calculating the external load based on UDL and also based on the point load is easy, taking the corresponding values of the deflections. But we need to identify what is this delta 1 and delta 2 once you identify the value of X. So to get this X, we need the external load, external work equated to the internal work, and find out what is MP as a function of X, and MP needed to be differentiated with respect to X, and find out X. And again, substituting the value of X back into that equation of MP, you get the value of MP. So compare the two MP and pick up the maximum MP. Design the section for that maximum MP and provide the same section for both the span AB and BC. So that's what the problem is. So the external work because of the UDL effect, and of course for the point load. So what is the UDL effect? Intensity of the load multiplied by the area of the mechanism. So that's where the area of the triangular part comes into picture. Half into base into height. So this height being delta 1 equal to X into theta. So that's what I have exercised here. As far as the second load is concerned, 100 into this distance into theta 1. So 2 into theta 1, and theta 1, as you know, as a function of theta. Put it back here, and this is what the expression in terms of X and theta. So what is the external work? So MP into theta, MP into theta plus theta 1, and of course it is MP into theta 1, because at these locations we have the MP. And also see in the problem, MP is same for both the spans. So that's where you need not have to worry. Otherwise, you need to take the appropriate value of the span moment. It may be 2 MP or MP depending on the situation. But at this support B, we need to take the minimum either to the left or to the right. So with that, we are getting another expression as a function of theta and X. Equate the two, that's what I have done it. And finally, you are going to get a very simple expression, something like this. And if you further simplify it, so you get 12 MP is equal to this much. And finally, an expression for MP. And differentiating that MP, you get the value of X as 4.33. And substitute back into the same expression, we are going to get MP as 117.4. Kindly see the value of X, 4.33. Is it really correct? Make a guess. Okay, go back to the diagram. So the span is 6 meter. If there were to be no concentrated load here, the hinge would have come exactly at the center at a distance of 3 meter. So because we have an additional load coming into picture, so probably the point where the bending moment is likely to be maximum will be towards the support C. So that's where you are going to get that point. And see the point where you are putting the load, concentrated load, that is at a distance of 4 meter. Span is 6 meter. So close to 4 meter, you can expect that the moment is likely to be maximum. But with the calculation, we are getting 4.33. Means it is slightly to the right of the concentrated load. So maybe the answer is correct. So that's what an approximate guess you will be able to make out, whether your calculation is really in the right direction or wrong. So that can be guessed. So once you get the maximum MP for this span and also for this span. So for the left span AB, I have the answer here. Kindly see the answer. It is 68.61. It's a very low value. Kindly see here. So here the moment is very high. So for this moment, we need to design the section. And also we have the formula for the laterally supported beam, where the cross section plastifies. MP is equal to Fy upon gamma MO into plastic section modulus. Find out the plastic section modulus and select a section for this where the Z plastic provided is slightly more than what is required, and do all the necessary checks as usual. So that is where the design of beam comes into picture. So as far as this problem is concerned, so straight away you have the answer. So friends, so with this class, I'm very sure that our students have really appreciated the two modules, module 1 and module 5. Module 1 is plastic analysis and of course some theory related to the limit state method of design. Module 5 is basically on the design of beams. So all the questions covering module 1 and module 5 from the question papers we have seen, and I'm not finding any question where you really cannot answer. But some questions are somewhat tricky as far as the plastic analysis is concerned, where we need to obtain an expression for MP, and that needed to be differentiated to get the unknown X and then work out the MP. Except for that small difficulty, so I'm not finding any difficulty as far as solving the questions of the question paper is concerned. So this is only to boost the confidence of the students. And with this, I am sure our students are really able to perform well in the examination. So I take this opportunity to thank all the students, and I wish that they will be able to do well in the examination. Wish you all the best and have a great future ahead. So thank you very much. In case you have any questions, you can send mail to me. Otherwise, you can also call to my mobile, and you can also have some interaction depending on the situation. So I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.